Hi, welcome back to The Shtick. We're going to be talking about your position as a chazzan, the cantor at StKilda Shule. Because it's such an amazing position for you to be in. And you get up and you lead the congregation in prayer and song.
Look, it definitely, Henry, to be honest, it is a privilege. But we talk about we're coming up to Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur soon. Mm-hmm. Next month is already Elul, the month preceding the High Holy Days, the month of introspection. And already now, the choir, my amazing choir, we've got over 20 people in our choir. And we're already starting to rehearse in between COVID lockdowns. And the responsibility actually on the shoulders of the chazan, I think, is huge. And it's something when we talk about the days of awe, awe in the real sense, I'm not talking about awesome, I'm talking about awesome, as in, divinely awesome. I feel that very much on my shoulders. And I think every chazan, really, when one goes into bat for the congregation, 1,000 people around me on Kol Nidre night, and there I am singing those words with that, call, that incredible melody that's even now sends goosebumps through me.
I got them too.
It is
just that one note,
honestly, one of the most incredibly I think powerful moments, but it's a big responsibility, and I feel so blessed to be able to be in the position that I am, in that amazing shul, surrounded by wonderful people. Incidentally, Rabbi Glasman, who is our senior minister, has put out an email to the congregants
and on Facebook yesterday,
which is why I know about it.
I wouldn't know otherwise.
There you go.
That he's taking 3 months off.
He is. He's been with the shul for 10 years.
Yep.
That's a long time. I started the year after him, and he has he's going in to do his MA, his master's in counseling.
Yes, so as if he needs it.
But that's true. Well, you know what? It'll just give the stamp on stamp on his certificate. But he is a real force, and together with Rabbi Nagle, Hillel, who is wonderful, Rabbi Figdor, the CEO, and we're also very blessed to have Rabbi Heilbrunn around, the Emeritus Rabbi Emeritus. When he's around, and he sits in his Emeritus chair, and we know that he's there because we hear his amazing tenor voice.
Now his voice, I mean, you've got a fabulous voice, but his voice is cracks the crystal.
He has a big instrument, and he's a wonderful guy too. So, so we've got an incredible team. We're very, very lucky.
And you're also a teacher of primary kids at GBH, Gandel Besen House.
When I travel, and we spoke about that, but when I travel, there's a little thing on the line item that says profession, and I'm always like, what the hell do I put down, type of thing. But I always put down teacher.
Because teacher's the most simple thing.
Yeah, and it's also a big calling, I think, of mine. I've been in education for 25 years. I taught at Scopus initially for 15 years in the high school. Mm-hmm. And then I was the director of Jewish life at Bialik College. And then I actually moved to Sydney for 3 years, where I was the head of Jewish life and learning there, which was the assistant position at the time, to the principal at Moriah College.
Moriah, of course.
I didn't mention that. So I was there for it. So I kind of feel that I've been around, I've seen the different schools, and we are so blessed in Australia to have such a robust Jewish education system. Challenges, obviously, pricing is very high, but the level of education is outstanding, and we see that in the results that we not
every
only the
year.
Academic results, but also the wonderful kids that come
the
out
products.
Of these institutions. Yeah, I feel very proud to have been a small cog in that wonderful wheel. But at the moment, I spent some time at Gandel Besen House at GVH in East St Kilda, which is kinders to year two. And I help the teachers there with the informal Jewish studies elements of the school. So the chagim, the assemblies, the different presentations, the graduations, and together with the team, we do lots of singing and lots of shtick. You would love it, Henry.
I'm coming there. Once we've opened up, I'm going to come and film a bit.
Exactly.
Although we're not allowed to film kids, we've got to put blurs on their faces. Too much political correctness. But we want to go on to your bar mitzvah teaching, which is what you do as well. You've got...
I've got 12 kids that I teach, 12
I don't know how you find the time to do it.
You know what? I think the more that one does, I think the richer life is.
Mm.
I started teaching bar mitzvah when I was at university. Obviously, I came here as an immigrant from South Africa. I didn't have my parents with me.
How old were you when you came out?
After school. Came straight after school.
Finished.
And so I needed to earn money to pay for my life. Mm. And so I started teaching the Barmy boys. And ever since, it's been something that has been a constant in my life.
Continuous.
And the reason I love it, Henry, is because there is a beginning and there is an end. You know, it's very, very, the process from the beginning to the end. And one can see the amazing reward at the end. And I've taught, I think the last count was close to 1,000 bar mitzvah boys, over the time. And it was my first job at Scopus. I took over from the amazing late Mr. Caspi taught, so many people out there, thousands of young boys in their time.
Yeah.
So I took over from him, which sort of then set me on my trajectory in my teaching career.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
And you also do teaching with a group an organization, the Anti-Defamation Commission, which you did in the past. I just mentioned it because we need to talk about that little episode in your life where you went out with Sharon Swatlow. We had you on the show.
Yeah.
We had Sharon on, in fact,
talking
about your effort to go out and teach people about anti-Semitism.
Right. It was a little period of time in my life, but the impact was really big, at least on me. It gave me the opportunity to go out and see schools that aren't necessarily within our little Jewish bubble.
Mm.
So we went out,
regional areas.
Yeah, we really got out into the sticks.
Yeah.
And the message wasn't only anti-Semitism. It was anti-Semitism, xenophobia, homophobia, Islamophobia. So it was
all forms of racism.
All forms of hate. The psychology
Hate.
Of hate. Why
That's
people
right.
hate. What drives hatred. What we can do about it. So
it was called Click Against Hate.
Correct.
Yes.
And the program is still in existence. And I've been out of it for a while, but it's a really worthwhile cause.
Fantastic.
It's quite amazing. Yeah.
And the last thing I wanted to mention is that you are online every Friday afternoon. And I get to see you on the Shtick group and also Jews of Melbourne. So you go online and you do all the Shabbat Kabbalat.
Yeah, yeah. So it started off the first week of lockdown, our first lockdown. I think it was March last year or something like that. And together with some wonderful kids, Isaac and Alex Itescu.
Yes.
And it's funny, I watched from last year and there were these little fishes and
I'm teaching Alex's bar mitzvah now, and
Isaac's already in your beautiful young boys.
Very talented.
Incredible. And Jason and Corey Fooks.
Yes, of course.
And the Yee boys more recently, Avram and Gabi Yee. And Henry, I can tell you that we haven't missed a Friday in 18 months.
How many have you done? You told me.
I calculated, I don't remember. You do the math, because we didn't just do the Fridays, we also do Chagim, and we did Mother's Day and Father's Day and all the special days and Yom HaTzma'ut and Yom HaZikaron, etc. And the most amazing thing for me is the community that we've developed.
Mm.
There are something, they're close to 10,000 people.
That's what you mentioned. That's
right. Who have engaged with this. And I spend, after Shabbat, hours, literally, going through and replying to messages of people from Barbados, from people, lots from South Africa, lots from the States, Canada, England, all over the world that have found somehow this has resonated with them and has given them the opportunity to engage with Shabbat in a way that they weren't able to because shuls weren't accessible. And also a lot of these people didn't go to shul.
No.
So all of a sudden they're having a Shabbat experience. And that for us has been, it's been one of the silver linings, I would say, of COVID for me. It's allowed me to connect with people all over the world and really special and amazing people. And I've formed great friendships with some of them.
Fantastic.
Wonderful, yeah.
We're going out now because we've got to go to the next segment. We're going to be talking about the joint, which people wonder, what the hell is the joint? You roll them up or what do you do? But it's one of the most amazing organizations I have ever heard of in the world, especially related to the Jewish community.
Mm-hmm. Well, it is. It
and
really
we'll
is.
Be talking about that in the next segment. We'll see you then.
Here we go. Everybody at home.